MRSA colonization is really, really common. I've never been tested. I don't want to know if I'm colonized with MRSA. I assume I am. Why wouldn't I be? I'm around MRSA patients all day long. If you just culture all comers, between 1% and 6% of ED patients are MRSA colonized, and somewhere between 5% and 7% of ED caregivers are colonized. I don't know why it's not 100%. So what are things that matter? Well, we know this, right? Hand hygiene does matter. There a 2000 study long time ago, but it just showed, and this was when hand hygiene was kind of a novel thing. We should have been doing it, but we weren't doing it that well. But when they really focused on it, they cut down MRSA transmission in this hospital from 2.16 to 0.93 episodes per 10,000 patient days. And it dropped the rate of healthcare associated infections from 17 to 10%. So just basic things really help with that, right? You need environmental services to buy in. MRSA can live for months on things like the remote control thing on the bed or on light switches. Those things help. Gowns and gloves help some. What about dedicated stethoscopes? This was surprising to me. This only came out in 2018, and it was just looking at stethoscopes in an ICU, and they had four different choices you could be randomized to. It could be the usual, let's say plan A, which is I just wear the same stethoscope around all the time. I clean it. I come out of the room and I make a big show that I'm cleaning my stethoscope, but I just do my own thing. It's what I've always done. And 10%, and then they cultured those, and 10% were clean and 90% were colonized with all kinds of crap. Then a standardized, they said, okay, just do your usual thing, but we're going to have a protocol when you come out where you do a standardized clean of your stethoscope when you get out of the room so that we're all doing it the same way and we're doing a thorough clean. And by doing that, 50% of the stethoscopes were clean and 50% were disgusting. What if we leave a stethoscope in the room and then we only use that stethoscope with that patient? You know, that's the one, the model that certainly we use at Dartmouth. It was still covered with, 50% of them were still covered with skin flora, gut flora, oral flora, and not just from that particular patient. So even with the dedicated stethoscope, we're probably doing things, we're bringing germs in from other rooms, or we're doing something to get the germs to go from room to room. Now, if you open a new stethoscope each and every time somebody listens to that patient, that is the way that you have nothing on the stethoscope. That was the only way you had nothing on that stethoscope. The only other thing I'll say, just back, let me make one other point. The part of our stethoscope that is most frequently, has the highest concentration of pathogens, where do people think it is? Earpiece, exactly. And I, for one, I cleaned the tubing and made a really big show of cleaning the bell and cleaning the diaphragm and I cleaned the tubing. I never thought to clean, but you do that and you walk into the room, you wash your hands, you go into the room, then you take the earpieces and you put it in your ear and you've now got bacteria all over your hands. So when you clean your stethoscope, get the earpieces too. So what about MRSA colonization? Should we be, if they identify me as the Johnny Appleseed of MRSA in my ER, should they eradicate it in me? Or if a patient's getting MRSA abscesses, should we treat that patient to decolonize them? We do know people who are colonized are at increased risk for future MRSA infections. And we consider it in those who keep getting MRSA over and over. Well, what is the treatment? You got to do the mupirocin in the nose, which is where a lot of it lives to colonize. You have the chlorhexidine in the skin. You can add oral antibiotics. You can do a bunch of stuff. Here's what they found with decolonization is that it doesn't last. There's a small study that said if you did all this, plus you took 7 days of doxycycline plus rifampin, so you're putting this stuff in your nose, you're washing your skin, you're taking antibiotics, you could clear your colonization for exactly 3 months. And then after 3 months, everybody went back to their baseline colonization rate. So you knocked it down for 3 months by doing that stuff, but it came back. And what about healthcare workers? Should they do us? So 4 to 15% are colonized in their nasopharynx. One study found that a third of inanimate hospital sites like railings and chairs and stuff were MRSA positive. 80% of our stethoscope earpieces are colonized. And you can decolonize healthcare workers, same as the previous regimen. And in healthcare workers, we're going to go back and start seeing patients, and 26% of us will be recolonized at 4 weeks, and everyone's going to be recolonized who was prior is going to be recolonized at 6 months. So really, there's no real support for doing it. Occasionally they will do it if they have like in an ICU and they serotype it out and there's one kind of MRSA that keeps showing up over and over again and they can trace that to a healthcare worker, they'll decolonize that worker, but you have to do it understanding it's going to come back. What about bare below the elbows? We got an email about this in my hospital like a month ago. And the first thing I did is I sent these papers saying, why are we doing this? But there's a thought, you know, should we have nothing below our elbows so we can really get clean arms and hands? And there's a couple studies on this that say it really doesn't make much difference. So this was a 2010 study that said, can't have anything below your elbow, not sleeves, not watches, not jewelry, nothing there. And so they randomized physicians to bear below the elbows in 92 doctors. And then at the end of a bunch of days, they agarplated their fingers. And there was absolutely no difference in the colonization of the hands in the bare below the elbows versus the non-bare below the elbows people. The only difference they could ever find is that the male doctors were much dirtier than the female doctors, and they thought male doctors should wash their hands more often overall. And then rings, should we be taking off our rings when we go to work? Because, you know, are there tons of bacteria living just underneath my ring? There, you know, should wedding bands be banned? Wedding bands be banned from caregivers? There are two small studies, one in the U.S., one in the U.K. The U.K. one, they did a surgical scrub with the ring on, then a swab, you know, with the ring on, and then they did a swab of the ring and they plated it. And there was no difference of the hand with the ring versus without the ring, and the same in the U.S. There was no difference. So wearing a ring did not also cause any increased risk of being colonized. And then this is just the world's easiest study to do. It involved getting exactly two people to wash their hands and then spend the day either shaking hands with people or fist bumping people, doing all their usual hand care. But the person randomized to handshaking was supposed to shake people's hands as they usually did. And the other was supposed to say a fist bump. And then they plated the hand and fist at the end of the day. Even though they were doing their usual hand care, and there was way more bacteria if you shake hands with people than if you fist bump. So knuckle up with people instead of shaking hands.